However, that said, it is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, Chrysler has now announced to be making investments in Windsor and Brampton and not going to taxpayers for $700 million. I want to celebrate that. I think that is a real testament to the quality of work from the Chrysler workers and the product that they make. So this is, Premier, your reaction was one of shock. I was pleased, and I wasn't surprised by the announcement, because they're outstanding product.
Workers.
So the problem I have, Premier, is it looked like you were going to hand out hundreds and hundreds of millions of taxpayer dollars in a corporate giveaway when, in fact, it looks like it wasn't needed. So, Premier, how do you make that judgment call? How do you determine when you hand out suitcases full of cash? And how do you make a determination it's a good project based on the quality of outstanding work that Chrysler workers do? I think it's good news. Why don't you?
Be seated, please. Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, all I can say to the Leader of the Opposition is that our position on this side of the House is that working in partnership with business in this province and competing in the global marketplace, Mr. Speaker, is what we believe is critical and will keep the auto sector here, Mr. Speaker. And, you know, the comments that were made by the Leader of the Opposition were reckless. They were ill thought out, Mr. Speaker. They did not acknowledge the decades of support and partnership
order,
that we
please.
Have had with the auto sector, Mr. Speaker. And
order.
What I have said, Mr. Speaker, is that our door is open. We will continue to work and negotiate with the auto sector to keep those jobs here into the long term, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, thank you. Supplementary.
Well, let's get this straight. So we're getting the investment, we're getting the jobs, we're getting the new generation minivan, and the taxpayers are saving $700 million? Is this a good thing? And your answer troubles me, Premier, that you and actually your colleague in the NDP, Andrew Horvath, just seem to want out a handout suitcases full of cash, even if they're not weighted. You don't seem to have any kind of judgment if the project is requires provincial cash. And I worry that the Liberals have been nothing more than pushovers when it comes to these sort of corporate handouts. So I'll ask you again, Premier, since you're willing to give away hundreds of millions of dollars when it wasn't needed, how do you actually decide? When you give out your $3 billion a year in corporate handouts, how do you make a judgment whether it's actually needed or not, or if the business would make the investment anyway?
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the fact is that we were working very closely with the federal government, Mr. Speaker, which last time I checked was a Conservative government, Mr. Speaker, friends of the Leader of the Opposition, Mr. Speaker. They seem to understand that it's very important that all levels of government work with business, particularly the auto sector, not just this company, Mr. Speaker, not just Chrysler, but with the auto sector in general, to make sure that the conditions are in place to bring jobs to Ontario, keep the jobs that are here, Mr. Speaker, and more importantly, secure a future footprint for the auto sector in the province. That's the piece that the Leader of the Opposition does not seem to understand, Mr. Speaker, to the detriment of the discussion of the auto sector in Ontario.
Be seated, please. Order. The member from Leeds-Grenville will come to order. Final supplementary.
Yeah, it's odd, Speaker. The Premier seems angry because she doesn't get to hand out $700 million in a briefcase full of cash. I don't understand. My point of view, let's actually make Ontario attractive for all investment, get taxes down, get energy under control to reduce the red tape burden. I think the fact that companies are investing because of the quality of our workers without a government handout, that's a good thing. I don't know why the Premier's angry about that. But let me ask you this, Premier. You seem to view that the fact that we've lost 300,000 manufacturing jobs is because we didn't have 300,000 more corporate giveaways. I disagree. In fact, I think the greatest threat to auto jobs, agribusiness, manufacturing jobs is a continuation of the Liberal NDP coalition in the province of Ontario. That's the greatest threat. So I want to ask you, too, you gave Kellogg's Corporation
$2.5
million in a corporate handout. And then they closed down the London plant, throwing 550 workers out of a job.
Thank you.
Do you think that was a wise investment?
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, so, you know, I am very pleased that that Chrysler will proceed with its investments in both Windsor and Brampton, Mr. Speaker. We're pleased with that news, and you know that's very good news. But, Mr. Speaker, what the Leader of the Opposition needs to acknowledge and doesn't seem to understand is that we need, as a province, to have a relationship with the auto sector that will be a long-term relationship, Mr. Speaker, that there will be commitments long-term,
and
that there will be the ability to continue to partner with the auto sector. Mr. Speaker, I met with the governor of Missouri this morning. It's very important to the economy of Missouri that we have the auto sector thriving in both our jurisdictions. There's an interdependence, Mr. Speaker, between us and states like Missouri, Mr. Speaker, that are dependent on a strong auto sector, not just today, not just to 2016, but into the future. That's the piece that the Leader of the Opposition seems to be missing.
Thank you. A new question. Leader of the Opposition.
Here's the difference. I believe in attracting businesses across the board through lower taxes, affordable energy, working with the colleges for more skilled trade workers, knocking aside the red tape barriers by reducing the number of rules and regulations by a third. The Premier believes in raising tax energy for everybody else to hand out suitcases full of money. The problem is, Premier, that will only last until the suitcase of money runs out. Then they'll come back for more. So I'll ask you again, if you believe that your corporate giveaways works, why then did Kellogg's company that you gave $1.5 million to in a big grant then close down their factory, throwing out of work 550 men and women? How is that a wise investment of taxpayers' dollars if they took the money and ran?
Thank you
very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I think the Leader of the Opposition knows that there are particular circumstances with every country, Mr. Speaker, company. But I think he also knows that since 2009, Mr. Speaker, we have gained 440,000 net new jobs in this province, Mr. Speaker. And I think he also knows that if he listens to the leadership of companies like Cisco about why they are here and why they are expanding their businesses here, Mr. Speaker, he will hear, for example, Robert Lloyd, President of Development and Sales, Cisco. We find a very educated and loyal workforce here. And he goes on to say, we just go where the talent is and have the best environment, the predictability for us to build a workforce here in a good tax environment, Mr. Speaker. That is what Robert Lloyd said about Ontario.
Answer.
That is why businesses are coming here, Mr. Speaker. That is the solid foundation that we have been built and will continue to enhance,
Thank
Mr.
You.
Speaker.
Thank you.
I agree with what Mr. Lloyd said. I think we have tremendously skilled and educated and hardworking people here in the province of Ontario. I'd put our workers against anybody else in the world. I've got faith in them. But I ask you, if that's the case why Cisco came here, why the heck did you give them $200 million in a corporate handout? They're coming here for the quality of our workers. Why are you giving away suitcases of cash? I think because you want to cut a red ribbon because you've lost 300,000 jobs. So you say Kellogg's is a particular circumstance. You say Cisco came here for the workers, but you still give them $200 million. Let me ask you about Wintronics in Windsor. You gave Wintronics in Windsor $2.7 million in a corporate giveaway, and Wintronics said they would create 200 jobs. 2 years later, they're gone. The plant has been shuttered. It is empty. The lights are off.
Question.
Premier, do you think that was a wise investment of money, $2.7 million for zero jobs?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I really believe that the question that has to be asked of the Leader of the Opposition is, if we are competing in a global economy, Mr. Speaker, where other jurisdictions are putting on the table conditions like tax regime, like wages, Mr. Speaker, but also cash, Mr. Speaker, that actually would draw businesses in, Mr. Speaker, does he believe that we need to compete with those other jurisdictions around the globe? Or does he believe that we can just blinker ourselves, Mr. Speaker, and make a decision that we are not going to play in that playing field, that we are going to make up our own rules and we're not going to compete with other jurisdictions? We're going to compete with other jurisdictions.
Answer.
We've got a terrific workforce. We are not going to undermine it the way the Leader of the Opposition would, Mr. Speaker, and we are going to acknowledge that those other jurisdictions are competing with us.
Final supplementary.
Look, Premier, we're going to compete and win against the best in the world when we get rid of a lousy and corrupt Liberal government.
The leader will withdraw. Carry on.
Look, I've got tremendous faith in our workers. I think that we've got a reckless, expensive, and corrupt government that's put us deep in debt as under two OPP.
You cannot. Withdraw, please.
Okay, withdraw, Speaker. Chrysler made the investment without government cash, and you wanted to give them cash from taxpayers. You say Kellogg's was particular circumstances. I'm not sure what your excuse is for Wintronics.
Minister of Immigration, come to order.
Nestle in Trenton, Ontario, received $3 million in a suitcase full of cash from the Liberal government, two grants of $1.5 million each. And you said that would create 28 new jobs.
Thank you.
Premier, yesterday they laid off 25 more workers.
Yeah.
Please tell me that you're going to actually change your mind, adopt
our plan. Thank you. Stop the clock. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, what we're not going to do is fire 10,000 people from the education sector. We're not going to fire 2,000 healthcare workers. We're not going to drive down wages, Mr. Speaker. We're not going to weaken pensions. We're not going to cancel infrastructure projects in Mississauga and York Region and Toronto and Durham, Mr. Speaker. And we're not going to cancel job-creating green energy jobs that will create clean, renewable energy. We're not going to do those things, Mr. Speaker. That's what the Leader of the Opposition would have us
do. Member from Northumberland, Quinty West, come to order.
Leader of the Opposition to do is to speak to the people in Ford, who in Oakville, who are working for Ford, Mr. Speaker, the securing of 2,800 jobs that we did, Mr. Speaker, by investing $70.9 million. I'd ask him to speak to the people who are working for Toyota in Cambridge, Mr. Speaker, where 400 new jobs are being created because of our partnership. I'd ask him to speak to Original Foods in Dunville, Mr. Speaker, 150 new jobs. I'd ask him to speak to Conestoga Meatpackers employees in Breslau, Mr. Speaker, where 100 new jobs are being created. I'd ask him to speak to those people, ask them if they think that government partnering with business is a good idea, because that's what's created those jobs, Mr. Speaker.
Question, the member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. My question to the Premier. Yesterday, the Acting Premier and the Minister of Energy continued to defend Ontario's $1 billion annual subsidy for exports. Families paying some of the highest bills in Canada have a simple question. Why is the government unable to admit that this is not working for ratepayers?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I'm quite sure that the Deputy Premier and the Minister of Energy said no such thing. What I know, Mr. Speaker, is that there are relationships and contracts with jurisdictions, and that last year there was a $300 million net profit from those energy contracts, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Just a note to the Premier, your minister has had to correct that word on the record previously, and you may want to check at the end of this session. On average, Ontario families pay 8.5 cents a kilowatt hour to make electricity, and we're selling it to the U.S. at 2.5 cents. Where do you make the profit on that, Ed? To our east and our west, provinces are getting nearly double that price for the electricity they sell. They've cut out the middlemen and the Wall Street energy traders. Why is this government so unwilling to consider the same?
So, Mr. Speaker, I know the Minister of Energy is going to want to respond to this in the supplementary, but I just want to say this, that when we came in, when the previous government came into office in 2003, the energy sector was in a mess, Mr. Speaker. We have made investments that have made the energy sector stable, Mr. Speaker, predictable. We have invested in clean, new, renewable energy, Mr. Speaker. We've shut down the coal plants. The other day, yesterday or the day before, the third party suggested that they would hand a $100 check to folks across the province in the next couple of years, Mr. Speaker. That will not enhance the energy grid, Mr. Speaker. It will not improve or connect people in the north, Mr. Speaker, and there is no long-term plan in that to control energy prices. So, Mr. Speaker, it does not promote conservation. It is not a responsible plan, Mr. Speaker. So we have that responsible plan. Our long-term energy plan will do all of those things, Mr. Speaker, and we're going to go forward with it.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, thanks to 10 years of mismanagement, Ontarians feel like they're working harder than ever to support the hydro system. They don't feel the hydro system is working for them. And this is the truth. Your Minister of Energy has had to correct himself on the record about a claim that we were making profits on those sales. They've seen public data from Manitoba Hydro showing Ontarians are paying amongst the highest bills in this country. And they know bills are going up. Why is the Premier so determined to keep a broken status quo when people demand change to the system?
Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I appreciate the fact that we provided a briefing for the critic with the IESO, who is responsible for this particular issue. And yes, they clarified, Mr. Speaker. I want to read what they clarified. Revenue from electricity exports reduced costs for Ontarians by $300 million in 2013. And since 2006, Mr. Speaker, the costs were reduced by $2 billion. There's a debate whether it's a profit or not, but the fact of the matter is our export of electricity is reducing costs to ratepayers in the province of Ontario. And, Mr. Speaker, our IEI program is using surplus electricity to reduce electricity rates for industrial consumers in a big way, Mr. Speaker, and he doesn't even appreciate that.
Thank you. New question. We're from Timmins, James Bay.
My question is to the Premier. Once again today, Premier, we've heard the Liberals promising to get public sector salaries under control. My question is this. What's your cap? What is it going to be?
Minister of Government Services.
You know, Mr. Speaker, we've addressed this before, Mr. Speaker. You know, the opposition likes to come up with a kind of a bumper sticker slogan for all this. The fact of the matter is that the leader of the third party went out and put forward a hard cap and then had to swallow herself whole when people started to raise exceptions.
Exactly.
The fact of the matter is that public sector salaries, it's a complex issue. And what this legislation will do is allow us to collect all the relevant information to do the analysis and to come up with caps for different sectors, caps that make sense based on what's happening in the private sector and other jurisdictions, Mr. Speaker. Unfortunately for our side, it doesn't fit nicely on a bumper sticker, Mr. Speaker, but it's the responsible thing to do, and I'm not going to have to swallow myself whole at a press conference.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaking of bumper stickers, this is like a drive-by by Liberals. You're going to have legislation so that we can figure out what those salaries are, so we can figure out what we got to do? My God, we can do that now. You don't need legislation. So I'm going to ask you again. What is going to be the hard cap that comes out of this, or is this just more cynical Liberal politics that we've seen as of late?
Mr. Speaker, I'm a little bit surprised. I guess the honourable member didn't watch his leader's press conference because she went out and proposed a hard cap, and then someone brought up an exception. I believe it was a senior power executive, and she said, "Oh well, we'll have to have exceptions for it. It won't apply there." I mean, the fact of the matter, Mr. Speaker, is that we have a range of leaders within the public service whose salaries need to be based on private sector comparators as well as comparators in other public sector agencies. As I said, Mr. Speaker, It's not simple. It doesn't fit on a bumper sticker, but it's fair and responsible, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that we have public sector leaders who are paid appropriately, Mr. Speaker, but are not paid excessively. That's what this legislation will do, and I look forward to the New Democratic Party supporting it so that we can get it through the legislature and get on with this work.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
I think people are going to find it hard to swallow this. This is coming from the same government who has been happy to burn money for years, is claiming they're going to put out the fire. So give me a break. This is not a solution. This is a crass political exercise on the part of the Liberal Party in front of what might be a spring election. So I ask you again, give us a number. What is the cap that you are prepared to propose when it comes to salaries for these individuals who are extremely overpaid?
Minister.
As I say, Mr. Speaker, we will come forward with a set of caps depending on the circumstances, and I've answered that, Mr. Speaker. But what I was surprised is that my honourable friend didn't stand up and talk about the rest of the legislation that we proposed to bring forward to this legislature and suggest that the New Democratic Party, I am hoping, will support them. It encourages things, Mr. Speaker, such as the putting online of expenses by cabinet ministers and the premier, something that's done right now, but extends it, Mr. Speaker, to the leaders of the opposition and their
The Liberal Party
has been a bit forgetful in doing over the past couple of years.
Question: the member from Etobicoke.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Premier, about a month and a half ago, we requested a Freedom of Information request on your expenses for the year 2013. And then the letter came back February the 6th saying that if we paid $1,200, actually $1,185 to be exact, we could probably get the information. Now, we also know, and this has happened since I've arrived here, that they've been Tim Hudak and this caucus have been trying to get information on the gas plants and the cost of them, and it's been like pulling teeth, and it wasn't until the auditor finally showed up with the information that we had anything to go on at all. Now we know the police are involved in this. I want to know, how did you finally arrive at an accountability position where you're finally going to come forward and put information and make it open and transparent when all along you've been hiding everything?
Seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker. Thank you very much, and I know that the member opposite was not a member when I came into this office a year ago, but what I said when I came in a year ago, Mr. Speaker, was that we were going to open up the process. At that point, we talked specifically about opening up the committee and providing information on the relocation of the gas plants, to which all parties had agreed, but we said that we wanted to open up the process. Hundreds of thousands of documents, Mr. Speaker, have been placed before the committee. There have been dozens of people who have come before the committee to answer questions. I have been there twice, Mr. Speaker, so we did open that process. And on the issue of expenses, Mr. Speaker, I think the member of the member opposite would need to know that he's just wrong about that. My expenses are online. They're up to date. They were posted voluntarily, Mr. Speaker, along with the expenses of ministers and staff. And we did receive a Freedom of Information request, and it will be released through the normal Freedom of Information process, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Again, to the Premier, Mr. Speaker, the information on total dollars might be online, but the details that are required and that should be in your openness provision here were not there. And I just wonder why it's taken a whole year or even 10 years before this information finally comes forward. I think it's high time that this was done. You talk about your openness as far as the gas plants are concerned,
Attorney General,
but you know full well that it took the auditor and the police to finally get to the bottom of the matter.
Yeah.
So whether you've been here a year or 6 months, it doesn't matter. You weren't open.
Yeah.
When are you going to be open?
You Freedom, please. Thank you.
Premier.
Speaker, and I think that the member opposite knows that we have complied with all of the requests that the committee has asked of us, Mr. Speaker. We have provided thousands of pages of documents, Mr. Speaker. And as I said, there was a freedom of request put in, freedom of information request put in, Mr. Speaker, and the information will be released as part of that. There is a cost associated with those requests, Mr. Speaker, and in fact, there was a cost paid to obtain the Leader of the Opposition's expensive, Mr. Speaker, many of which are not online. There are very large gaps, Mr. Speaker, and a freedom of information request was filed, and there was a cost associated with that, Mr. Speaker. So I hope that this line of questioning from the member opposite implies that they will be supporting the legislation when it's introduced in the House, Mr.
Answer.
Speaker. I fully expect that they will do that.
New question. The member from Windsor-Tecumseh.
Speaker, thank you. My question this morning is for the Premier. Good morning, Premier.
Good morning.
First, I want to thank you for the phone call last night and keep me in the loop on the situation at Chrysler. Speaker, when there are jobs on the line, we need to set aside our political games and grandstanding and work to make investments happen. People in Windsor and Essex County are very concerned about the long-term future of our Chrysler plant and the jobs of the thousands of people who work there. What assurances can you give, Premier, that your government is doing everything possible to work with Chrysler to ensure its Windsor operations will remain viable?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member opposite for the question. I know that the Minister of Economic Development and Trade is going to want to speak to this. But, Mr. Speaker, I want to just say that I want to let everyone in this House know and the public know that the member for Windsor West has been Windsor West, right?
Yes.
Yes. The Minister of Children and Youth Services has been an absolute champion on this file, yeah. Mr. Speaker. That she has worked tirelessly to make sure. To make sure that our policy of having an open door and working for those long-term commitments, Mr. Speaker, were absolutely what we were doing at the table in conjunction with the federal government, Mr. Speaker. So the auto sector in this province and in Windsor, Mr. Speaker, has
Answer.
A huge champion in our member, and I hope, Mr. Speaker, that that we will be able to continue those negotiations.
Thank
and
you.
We have our door open.
Supplementary.
Speaker, I want to assure this House that my new Democratic colleagues and I take our responsibilities seriously when it comes to securing good auto sector jobs in this province. We're calling on all parties at all levels of government to set aside their political differences and pull together on this one. Premier. Can you assure our Chrysler employees, indeed our entire community, that your door remains open for future dialogue with Chrysler officials about the long-term viability of Windsor's assembly plant operations?
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hope the member opposite walks over and provides the Leader of the Official Opposition a copy of that letter right now, because currently the Leader of the Official Opposition is living in a fantasy land where he believes that his irresponsible and negative comments about the Chrysler negotiations at a particularly sensitive time in the negotiations, he's living in a fantasy land where he actually thinks that Chrysler's decision validates his irresponsible behavior. Mr. Speaker, and it's not simply our view on this side of the House, the Federal Minister of Industry, James Moore, has been working very closely with myself and supportive of this deal with Chrysler, has indicated that the HUDAC comments have been detrimental to the negotiations. That's not just his opinion. That's not just his opinion.
Answer.
He heard that directly from the head of Chrysler Canada, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Ottawa South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Government Services.
Good.
Speaker, I was pleased to be part of an announcement this morning in which you and the Premier spoke about our intention to introduce major enhancements in accountability for both our government and for members of this legislature.
Hear, hear.
Under Premier Wynne, our government has committed to leading by example and being as transparent and accountable as possible. Mr. Speaker, I was encouraged to hear this morning that these new proposed improvements would bring the same level, high level of transparency to members of this House. Since being elected to the legislature last fall, I've worked hard to bring the issue of the accountability of elected members to this House. Ontarians have a right to access in a clear way the information on how elected officials are spending their tax dollars. I was very happy to learn that the government plans to introduce new legislation that, if passed, would create a new open climate, a climate of open government and enhance accountability here in Ontario. Minister, can you outline to this House
how
the government will be proposing that the important improvements that we will make in posting expenses mandatory for all members?
Here.
Minister responsible for the government services.
Mr. Speaker, and I really sincerely want to thank the member for Ottawa South for his advocacy on this issue. I think members are aware of the private members' bill that he put forward on this. Mr. Speaker, as members are aware, today the Premier announced our proposed plan to introduce legislation to enhance accountability and transparency in government. Within that is our intention to introduce amendments which would require expense information for cabinet ministers, parliamentary assistants and opposition leaders and the respective staff to be posted online for anybody to see. As members may know, expense information for cabinet ministers, parliamentary assistants and their staff have been posted online on a voluntary basis by the government since 2010. The proposed amendments would, if passed, turn these voluntary practices into a mandatory requirement and extend the same requirement to opposition leaders and their staff. We expect the same level of transparency from everyone in the House. Mr. Speaker,
thank
at the
you.
Same time.
Okay. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's very encouraging news. Through you to the Minister, I'm glad to hear that under this proposal, all members of this House would be required to embrace the same level of accountability as members of Cabinet and parliamentary assistants. I am especially impressed that the leaders of the opposition parties would be required, if the legislation passes, to be as accountable as the Premier and Cabinet Ministers. Mr. Speaker, as representatives of the people, we must all hold ourselves to a higher standard. Mr. Speaker, Ontarians not only expect transparency from their elected officials, but also from the people working in the agencies funded with their tax dollars. Mr. Speaker, in speaking to Ontarians about my private member's bill on this issue, they often ask what is being done to enhance accountability, not only for elected officials, but for officials working in agencies.
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Since 2010, expense information for senior executives, appointees, and the top five claimants in 21 of the government's largest agencies and organizations are required to be posted under the government's Travel, Meal, and Hospitality Expense Directive. Ministry senior managers are covered under this directive as well. Expense claims undergo a rigorous approval process, first within each of the organizations and then by the Integrity Commissioner. In our announcement today, we've committed to proposing new improved oversight powers of the Integrity Commissioner to review the expenses of all of Ontario's 197 classified agencies. If passed, this proposed legislation would allow the Integrity Commissioner to select any number of these agencies and review the expenses of their executives. Mr. Speaker, the Premier has committed to making the Government of Ontario the most accountable government in Canada. Measures like these would, if passed, go a long way to ensuring that Ontarians can access this important information.
New question, member from the Peel Tarleton.
Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Hopefully I won't have to pay $1,200 for an answer. The government has found itself in the middle of a white-collar crime investigation by the elite OPP anti-rackets squad for its role in the cancelled gas plants and its role in the deleted emails that attempted to suppress opposition concerns. Yesterday, hard drives from government computers were seized. We know 20 Liberal officials have been interviewed by the OPP. We know the Premier's own office was visited by the OPP, and we know that if charges are laid, those responsible could face up to 14 years in jail. Ontario Liberals have now seen their government under investigation twice by the OPP. They have broken international law. The Premier herself refuses to hand over her expenses unless you pay $1,200. And what makes this more vile is she has no mandate from the people.
None.
The honourable thing is for her to call an election. Will she do it? Will she seek a mandate from the people?
Be seated, please. Thank you, Premier.
House Leader.
Robert Helston.
You know, Mr. Speaker, this question really is beneath the member. It really is, Mr. Speaker.
No, I don't say that.
The Ontario Provincial Police is undertaking work, and I think all members of this House recognize the fact that we allow the Ontario Provincial Police to undertake their work. We don't reach conclusions on our own. We don't speculate, Mr. Speaker. But it's interesting, Mr. Speaker, because perhaps in the supplementary, the honourable member can talk about our new piece of legislation, because she mentioned some of the concerns around emails. Well, in fact, that legislation contains responses to the Information and Privacy Commissioner's recommendations in that regard, so I look forward to a support on it. The other thing it does, Mr. Speaker, is it makes it mandatory for the Leader of the Opposition to post his expenses, something, Mr. Speaker, through our Access to Information Act, where at request, Mr. Speaker, we found out he hasn't been doing. In fact, we found $15,000 of expenses that he forgot to put on his website, Mr. Speaker. So perhaps she wants to address that.
It was the Truth in Government Act put forward by the Ontario PC Caucus 4 years ago that would have addressed that. But I'm going to have the page take this over to the Premier. This is the $1,200 bill she sent the Ontario PC Caucus to get access to her information and her expenses. And I'll also throw in all of Tim Hudak's expenses as well, just so they have it. But the facts, Speaker, they speak for themselves. Two OPP investigations, one broken international law, and a government without a mandate, Speaker. The Premier appears to be clinging to the wood paneling in her office with clenched fingernails, so she can't leave the office because she just wants the power. The right thing to do, the honourable thing to do, is to call an election, get rid of the scandal, get rid of the controversy, create the jobs, reduce the taxes. That's what Ontarians want. They can't deliver it. Well, they do the right thing.
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I wish that the opposition had been as forthcoming when it came to the Leader's expenses when we had to go through the Freedom of Information process to get it and wait for the requisite amount of time. But what was most interesting, Mr. Speaker, and I do want to correct my record, I think I said 15,000, but in fact, Mr. Speaker, there was $13,271.30 charged to taxpayers by Mr. Hudak that is missing from his public postings, including flights and accommodations. Mr. Speaker, the point behind this legislation, and again, I listened carefully and didn't hear the honourable member express her support for it, but the point behind this legislation, Mr. Speaker, is to encourage, shall we say, force the leaders of the two opposition parties to do, Mr. Speaker, what our government has been doing voluntarily since 2010.
A new question. Member from Niagara Falls.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Last week, 4,000 people showed up at job fair for the opening of a new mall in Niagara-on-the-Lake. That's a testimony to how much our region needs jobs. Instead of helping businesses in Niagara create jobs, this government is raising the cost with skyrocketing hydro bills while subsidizing private companies in Western New York with cheaper hydro. What is the government's plan for Niagara businesses when competing against Western New York in relation to electricity prices?
Thank you, Premier.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm pleased to take this question as well and talk about the important progress that we've made in job creation right across this province. And of course, since the bottom of the recession, Mr. Speaker, we've added nearly 450,000 jobs. But the most recent data, and I'm looking forward to the jobs data coming out tomorrow, but the most recent data show that we're making progress, not just generally in terms of bringing those jobs back, 6,000 jobs last month, for example, in the month of January. We're going to hear about February tomorrow. But also, importantly, 7,800 new jobs for our young people. And I can't help myself but to reference my colleague in the back, the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities. An important part of that progress that we're seeing on youth job creation is our Youth Jobs Fund. And under his careful stewardship, we have more than 8,000 young people across the province
who
have positions, training positions, and those first opportunities with employers across the province, including the Niagara region.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. A new report shows that one in every two residents in Niagara Falls is struggling financially. At the same time, we saw 4,000 people standing in line in hopes of finding a job. any job, even part-time. Niagara Falls has massive amount of cheap hydro electricity in our own backyard. Yet businesses and ratepayers are paying the highest energy prices in the country, much higher than Western New York. Premier, why are ratepayers subsidizing the export of electricity to businesses in Western New York can hire while people in Niagara face the highest unemployment in the province?
Minister.
To the Minister of Energy.
Minister of Energy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First of all, we do have surplus energy, Mr. Speaker, and that's good. We came from a deficit situation. We invested heavily in the system. We do sell electricity, Mr. Speaker, and we reduced the cost to our system last year by $300 million. But we also are turning our thoughts and our direction towards using surplus electricity to support Ontario businesses. We created the Industrial Electricity Incentive Program, Mr. Speaker, and that is providing electricity to companies that want to expand or settle in Ontario by giving them electricity at about 50% reduction, Mr. Speaker, at 50% discount. We've announced about six or seven of those companies. We are also not supporting New York companies anymore. That surplus energy is in Ontario for
Thank
Ontario
you.
Businesses.
New question, member from Mississauga, East Cooksville.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Education. Minister, a lot of parents in my riding are a little confused and concerned as to what is going on with collective bargaining in the education sector. Now, my parents understand that there is an urgency for the speedy passage of the government's proposed Bill 122, the School Board's Collective Bargaining Act, but do not understand why a legislation that was introduced back in October is still stuck in the legislative process. We've heard you say many times that this is a bill you've been working closely on with all of our partners in education when it was developed. So could the minister please explain why such a bill, which is the result of such extensive consultation and collaboration, has come to a standstill in the legislative process?
Thank you, Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much, Speaker, and thank you to the member for raising such an important issue.
Yeah, very important.
First, this member is absolutely correct that the speedy passage of this bill is extremely important. This bill would create central tables for collective bargaining with formal roles for the province, the trustee associations, school boards, teacher federations, and support staff unions. This due process would encourage discussion, promote innovative ideas, and ensure every partner has a clear role to play. The proposed model, Speaker, would help us promote constructive dialogue and maintain positive, respectful relationships with our education partners in the best interests of the students who are here today. Speaker, it is important to understand that this is a made-in-Ontario approach to collective bargaining that was developed through extensive consultations with our education partners. It will help us do collective bargaining, and we need it passed.
Thank you. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. Listening to your response, it struck me that instead of the opposition holding the government to account, we are now in a situation where the government is having to hold the opposition's feet to fire to ensure our children's education is not sacrificed at the altar of petty political gamesmanship. My understanding, Speaker, is that things have come to such a pass that yesterday we had to vote in this legislature to seek permission to sit during constituency week for the committee. Now, I understand that that sitting is also at risk. So could you, Minister, please tell us yet again why this legislation is at risk of the official opposition's political games?
Minister.
Yes, thank you, Speaker, and I'd be happy to explain what's going on here. As the member mentioned, when a similar motion passed in this House last fall, allowing the committee to sit during the winter break, the official opposition chose to boycott the process. This is the same risk we are now facing from the same party that finally yesterday decided it had an education plan. So, Speaker, I am calling on all members of this legislature to ensure that what happened happened in the winter break doesn't happen next week, and that the committee will sit for clause by clause consideration so the legislation can move through the process. Throughout the course of the day, I've seen the chair and the subcommittee members sitting here, and I call on those subcommittee members to meet immediately after question period and get this sorted out so they can meet next week and do clause.
Thank you. New question. The member from Halliburton, Florissa Lake Sprott. Stop the clock. Stop the clock. Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
The Liberals always show up.
The member from Halliburton, Florissa Lake Sprott.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Premier, I have a letter from the Trent Gervais, the manager of the Peterborough Airport, expressing his strong objections to the approved Sumac Ridge wind turbine project. This airport is a great source of economic development for not only my riding of Halliburton, Kawartha, Lakes Brock, but for the city of Peterborough. It boasts the longest paved runway between Ottawa and Toronto at an astounding 7,000 feet. Millions of dollars have been invested by all three levels of government to see this airport grow.
What?
Seneca College's School of Aviation opened its doors there in January, and it's expected to generate $12.32 million of economic activity in the community each year and support 151 jobs. With Seneca and five other flight schools operating out of the Peterborough Airport, the safety of new pilots is now at risk because of the siting of this wind turbine project. Since the Minister of Rural Affairs won't stand up for the people in his riding of Peterborough, I'm standing here today on behalf of his...
Stop the clock, please. Stop the clock, please. I've made a comment about this before, about talking about other people's ridings. I would caution the member not to do that again. Please finish your question. We have time for wrap-up.
Will you stop the Sumac Ridge project and let the Peterborough Airport get back to the business of creating the much-needed jobs?
Thank you.
Mr. Energy.
Mr. Speaker, the member knows that FIT contracts, renewable contracts, allow for termination only in cases where project developers do not meet their contractual obligations. And the OPA could be subject to legal action if it terminates FIT contracts for projects which have met their obligations. Having said that, Mr. Speaker, there is a process, an environmental process, and an appeal to that environmental process, Mr. Speaker, to deal with issues. Mr. Speaker, the Leader of the Opposition in his Million Jobs Act has indicated that he would give the Minister of Energy authority to cancel those contracts.
Order.
Mr. Speaker, that would expose the provincial government to over $20 billion.
Member from Simcoe Gray, I asked you twice.
We're not prepared to do that. We are prepared to adhere to the environmental process, the appeal process, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
And I will hopefully be able to refer the supplementary to the Minister of Environment on that issue.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings will come to order. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. To whichever minister is going to take the next question, I guess. There's lots of, certainly, Ministry of Environment outs for that contract. I asked the Premier on Monday to call a moratorium on wind turbines, to which he responded the Liberal government has, and I quote, put new rules in place and that you would give communities more input on siting. In the letter from the manager of the Peterborough
Attorney General, come to order.
He says these wind turbines are threatening the success of this business, putting up barriers to job creation and risking the safety of flight patterns and approaches. It's kind of important. So your government clearly did not have the necessary guidelines and regulations in place before citing this project. So you claim your government has new rules in place. Why is it that you cannot listen to this community, like
out.
You said you would, and cancel the wind turbines at the Sumac Ridge?
Just do the right thing. Cancel the project.
Minister of the Environment.
Minister of the Environment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Of course, there is a process which has been established to allow people to have the appropriate input on matters of this kind. The proponent has to go through a very rigorous regime to ensure that that proponent would be in compliance with the regulations set out by the Ministry of Energy and by the Ministry of the Environment.
Exactly.
And I am confident that all aspects of this issue will be dealt with appropriately through the process. Ministry of the Environment officials and indeed officials of other ministries which provide comments in these circumstances are always pleased to hear from those who have views to express and are respectful of those views being expressed by those individuals and give serious consideration to them. So I encourage all to participate in that process, ensure that those views are put forward, and I can tell you that they will be considered seriously, as they always are.
Thank you. New question, member from Nickelbelt.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
The Minister met with the Mayor of Thunder Bay and City Councillor, who expressed their concern over the ongoing problem with their local health care system. After 50 long days of gridlock caused by an overwhelming number of patients who should not be in their hospital but have nowhere else to go, the hospital is now facing a deficit. Will the minister recognize that the hospital should not be forced to cut services because of a lack of capacity in their community?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member opposite for the question. This is an issue that I have been discussing daily with the members from Thunder Bay Superior North and Thunder Bay Atikokan. They are keeping me informed on a daily basis about the challenges in Thunder Bay. I'm very much aware of it. I know the hospital, the Community Care Access Center, the Lynn, the city, everyone is working together to develop a plan to rectify the situation. It is unacceptable what's happening at Thunder Bay. I will be the first to admit that, and I look forward, Speaker, to be able to speak directly with the people of Thunder Bay on how we're going to move forward.
Cue supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, the minister is partly right. The hospital is working with the Community Care Access Centre, with the LHINs, and with any other community-based organizations to try to address the community problems. But the weeks of gridlocks have taken their tolls on the hospital budget. Thunder Bay Regional Hospital Health Science Centre is running a deficit of about $2.4 million and is looking at cutting services to balance their books like they are mandated to do by law. What is the minister going to do to address this ongoing problem and the hospital deficit that comes with it?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, as I said in the initial question, the situation in Thunder Bay is not acceptable, and that's why we are working to support the community, because they have come together and offered some solutions, Speaker. So this is very much a project that's underway. I am very much focused on finding resolution to this, and as I say, I look forward to being able to communicate with the people of Thunder Bay about some of the steps we can take in addition to those we have already taken to rectify the situation.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Scarborough-Guildwood.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment. Ontario's tech sector is a vital part of our economy, both across the province and locally in my constituency, with thousands of tech grads from institutions in and around my riding of Scarborough-Guildwood. I know firsthand the importance of a strong tech sector in Ontario. Just recently, Cisco has renewed their commitment to continuing their R&D operations. As a significant employer, they are an integral part of Ontario's economy. Speaker, it is important that we continue to create and retain jobs across the province and ensure that we are supporting key sectors like tech. These are competitive times, and Ontario has proven it can compete globally on the world stage, remaining one of the highest-ranking jurisdictions in North America when it comes to foreign direct investment. With Cisco's recent announcement to create an R&D hub in Toronto, could the minister please update the House on what our government's recent partnership means for Ontario?
To Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member from Scarborough-Guildwood for this important question. I have to say I'm very excited and proud of this announcement yesterday by CIMCO. I had the honour of attending, along with the Deputy Mayor of the City of Toronto and other business leaders and dignitaries, where Cisco announced, it's quite remarkable, a $100 million investment in this city to create what they're calling the Internet of Everything Innovation Centre. And this is a centre which is going to be available to support startups, Mr. Speaker, to work on business-to-business relationships, and really to significantly grow the economy and grow the IT sector in Ontario. And I should mention that this is only the fourth of Cisco's innovation centers in the entire world. So we're following. They have one in South Korea, one in Brazil, one in Germany, and we are the only innovation center for Cisco in all of North America. So this really was an important announcement. And of course, it comes on the heels of our important and positive announcement in December with Cisco, where they're investing $4 billion over the next 10 years to create as many as 3,700 jobs, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for the update. While the tech industry in my riding and across the province will continue to see the strong commitment our government is making in the industry, there are still some concerns from my constituents about the overall growth of the tech sector. We know Ontario has fared better than many other jurisdictions in North America, and that our economy is back on track, having recovered all the jobs lost during the global recession. We know having a good job to wake up to every day is what keeps Ontario strong. Speaker, through you, back to the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment, what is the government doing to support the continued growth by helping to create good, meaningful jobs in Ontario's tech sector?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, thank you again for the question. And although I know that the PC party does not support our partnership with Cisco, they didn't support the investment that we made to secure that $4 billion investment, the creation of 3,700 jobs. But this partnership, Mr. Speaker, is the largest job-creating investment in the history of Ontario's and Canada's tech sector. It really is unprecedented, and it will certainly enhance Ontario's reputation as a leader in research and innovation. It's also a great example of how the government of the day can work together with the private sector to realize these important investments. Mr. Speaker, we have more than 250,000 people working in the high-tech sector in Ontario. Last year, we were third in North America after California and Texas. Well, I'm happy to say that we've taken that second-place spot away from Texas.
Yeah.
We're actually number two in all of North America after Silicon Valley in terms of IT investments.
New question. The member from Perth Wellington.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Premier, your government's 2012 budget devastated the horse racing industry. And as we all know, the NDP allowed that budget to pass, putting thousands of people out of work. You set up an expensive transition panel. You set up another new bureaucracy and a funding program with no details. You raced to the rescue of Fort Erie just days before a by-election, but racetracks across Ontario are still waiting for their race dates. Some are waiting to see if they'll even have a season. I asked the Premier, how many contracts have you signed?
Good question.
Good question.
Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I think the member opposite knows that the plan that we have put in place is a stable plan that will allow the horse racing industry to stay on track, Mr. Speaker, into the future. The slots at racetracks plan, Mr. Speaker, was not transparent. It was not sustainable, and Mr. Speaker, it had to be changed.
Order.
We have made that change. John Snowblin and Elmer Buchanan. And John Wilkinson, Mr. Speaker, worked to make sure that the $400 million that we put in place will establish that framework going forward, Mr. Speaker. So I hope that the member opposite understands that the Ontario Racing Commission announced the details of the 2014 components of the Horse Improvement Program, Mr. Speaker. We are working with breeders. We are working with the tracks to make sure that those dates are in place, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Again, to the Premier. Premier, if this is a stable plan, it should be in the stable. Well, Speaker, I've spoken to the horse racing industry leaders, and they are fed up with this government's delays. They are tired of excuses. They are frustrated because they can't plan this year's season, which may or may not even exist. It's my understanding the contracts are due to be in place by April the 1st. It is now March the 6th, and I am told that racetracks are still waiting to hear if their race dates have even been approved. When can racetracks expect to hear from you so that they can begin planning their upcoming season? When will you pick up the phone, and when will you finalize race dates?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The ORC negotiations are ongoing, and I'm sure that the member opposite knows that. He knows that it was important that we have those individual, that there be those individual conversations with each track, because each track is different. And the fact is, Mr. Speaker, the Fort Erie situation is different from the other tracks, Mr. Speaker, and those negotiations are ongoing. My intention is that we have a stable industry, Mr. Speaker, that is transparent, that that works for all sectors of the horse racing industry, Mr. Speaker. I made that commitment when I came into this office. We put the panel had been put in place by my predecessor, and we have now got a plan that is sustainable, and we will be working with the tracks to make sure that they have those dates for 2014, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Parkdale High Park.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Attorney General. Partner assault response programs play a vital role in holding abusive men accountable for violence against women and keeping women safe. Each year, about 14,000 men participate in a partner assault response program, most of them through court order. Yet the province only provides funding for about 9,000 of these offenders. Minister, why did your government arbitrarily decide to reduce the length of the PAR program from 16 to 12 weeks just to cut costs, without any research on how this change will affect family safety?
Thank you, Attorney General.
Well, thank you very much for the question, and she's quite correct that the Partner Assault Response Program is a very important component of our coordinated response to domestic violence. And she's also correct that we have changed the number of weeks that a member, an individual, can be part of this program from 16 to 12 weeks. But one of the reasons why we did that is that there are many more people now that need that kind of service. The funding has not been cut. It's still exactly the same amount as it was last year at $10.6 million. We found, Speaker, that there was simply too long a delay for new individuals that needed the service to get into the program. So what we have done is we have slightly reduced the number of weeks that each participant will be involved in the program, so that the individuals that need the service can be dealt with a lot quicker. Because it has gone from something like 11,000 individuals 2 or 3 years ago to 14,000 today. People shouldn't have to wait for 4 to 6 months to get into the program.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Again, to the Attorney General. This government, by the way, has allowed 15,000 women to be turned away from emergency shelters due to lack of funding, potentially back into the hands of those abusers. Partner assault response programs are an essential component of a coordinated community response to women, giving offenders the opportunity to examine their beliefs and attitudes toward domestic abuse and to learn non-abusive ways of resolving conflict. The ministry's own provincial advisory committee has recommended against this change. Why is this government ignoring the advice of its own experts and pushing through a change that is putting women's lives at risk?
Attorney General.
Well, Speaker, as I mentioned before, the number of people that are in the program has gone up from 11,000 to about 14,000 in the last 2 to 3 years. We want to make sure that these individuals that need this much-needed service, so that we can reduce domestic violence, can be treated as quickly as possible. There has been no evidence at all that a 12-week program isn't just as efficient and good for the individuals involved as a 16-week program. The funding has not been cut. The organizations are aware of that. There has been an awful lot of consultations with all of these good groups in our province that are doing this kind of work. And I think that it's very important that people get access to the program as quickly as possible, because they are in the greatest need immediately after their first charge. It's a good program. We're continuing the program.
Thank you. There are no deferred. The member from Windsor-Tecumseh on a point of order.
Order, Speaker. Yes, I want to commend you for hosting your annual Speaker's Book Awards last night, honoring Ontario's authors and publishers. And it was great to see Charlie Angus, the federal MP from Timmins-James Bay, win the competition last night. And also the father of the member from Haldimand Northfork, who was there and was one of the finalists as well. You did a great job last night, Speaker. I hope you continue honoring Ontario's authors and publishers. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate the member's comments, and all of our authors were very thrilled, and our publishers were of the same opinion. So we want to celebrate literacy in Ontario. Write a paragraph. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon.